Greetings, Tony from Old River Hard Goods again. Today's video is going to be kind of a compilation of a number of restorations I've done over the past few months. We've got some early braces, draw knives, some bevels, a couple molding planes, and a few other goodies thrown in there as well. So, lots to cover, so hope you enjoy it. Also, on March 10th, I will be hitting the road to Damascus, Maryland, that is, for the annual PATINA tool show. March 10th is dealer setup day, but the public can come in if you want to buy an early bird ticket. The actual sale begins on Saturday, March 11th, 2023. And there's lots of tailgating, weather permitting, going on both days. So if you go on down, make sure you stop by and say hello. And it's on with the show. Here are the four braces. The one on the left is a Taylor patent. Jeremy Taylor was granted patent number 9814X on June 30th, 1836 for the design of this particular brace. They were made by a number of makers. I don't know that he ever made them himself. And I didn't see a maker's name on this one yet, but we'll look and see. The next two are Spofford patents. Nelson Spofford was granted patent number 25984 on November 1st, 1859 for the design of this particular brace, actually for the chuck. Most of these were made by Frey or Frey and Pig, later ones made by Stanley. And the last one is kind of a mystery brace. Yeah, let's see if I can get in here. Well, it has the Spofford-style chuck. It's a different screw, different grip, and the pad's a little different. I had one of these, about a year ago. It was similar, couldn't find a name on it. We'll see what turns up with this one. In case anyone's wondering, this is a 6-inch sweep, an 8-inch sweep. This one's a 14-inch sweep, and this one's also an 8-inch sweep. First one I'm going to work on here is the Taylor patent. Now this one's had some repairs in the past. The pin for the lever was replaced with a copper one at some point. I know the originals were iron, but it works. Somebody put a nail in to keep the pad on. I'm not sure I want to mess with that because it just doesn't really affect things, and who knows what other worms will crawl out of that can. There's also a hole drilled on this side. Looks like somebody was planning on putting a thumb screw in at some point, but it was never tapped. So I'm going to go run it over to the Rurley machine, and we'll see what's what when I'm done with it. And here we have the finished product. This cleaned up pretty well. I did take it for a ride on the wheel. But these guys were finished bright to start with, so unless they're exceptionally rusty to begin with, they usually clean up pretty good. See the chuck area, the grip. Inside the chuck, that also cleaned up pretty well. I did take a little sandpaper to that, and then I put some of my special wax mix down inside, just to keep it from future rusting. Inside of the pad had some rusting on it, which I took off with some steel wool and a fine brass brush by hand. And then I hit that with a little bit of my wax mix as well, just to kind of make it look pretty again. Those were, I believe, Japan'd originally, although that didn't last too long. I think some of these pads were as well, but that didn't last very long. And I put a little oil down on the inside, and it runs pretty smooth. So, again, this is a 6-inch model. It's not very common. This 8-inch Spofford. Still don't know who made it, if it's a Frey and Pig or just a Frey. See, this one's got a fair amount of patina. And I'm going to do some light sanding on it with the 400 grit paper before taking it over to the wheel. Okay, I've given this guy a light sanding, like I said, with 400 grit paper. And I use my well-worn but still usable fine wire brush, the brass brush, to give it a good cleaning, a little bit of a cleaning. I don't know if you can see it here or not, but this one does have the Spofford patent date on it. So this is definitely one of the older ones. And there's some pitting on it, but we'll see how it looks after it goes through the, spend some time on the wheel. Screw, I didn't do any cleaning on yet, but that'll just buzz off real fast. So off we go, and I'll be back. Okay, here we have the finished product. There is some pitting. I mean, you know, you do the best that you can. But pad cleaned up pretty well. Those were Japaned, like on the tailors, and the pads were also Japaned originally, but those didn't last too long. See some of pitting here. But the chuck's good. Pad does have some play on the shaft, and I did shoot some oil in there, and it's still working out. That'll take a couple of days till I get that completely cleaned out. This one is a Frey product. What I thought was a patent date just says John S. Frey. And on this side it says Spofford patent, which is how they marked a lot of them, if you can see that. But overall, considering this thing's got to be, what, 125, 135 years old at the least, it's not too bad. I decided to pass on working on the 14-inch Spofford because it's got a lot of problems. It's going to take me way more time than I want to put into it at this point. But this is the last one. Again, this is a Spofford brace. But it's not signed. And like I said before, I've only ever seen one other one like this. So I don't know if this was a knockoff or a special order job. I mean, it's pretty basic. Nothing fancy about it except for the wood handle and pad. And it cleaned up okay. There's some pitting, some dings on the chuck. Pad's a little sticky in spots, but it does turn. The grip's got some play up there. But the screw works, and it holds a bit straight and true. So it's a neat brace, and it's a collectible one at that. And here we have a really nice 18th century blacksmith forged iron brace. Needs a little cleanup, which I'm going to do. But see the chuck area here. Pad's got some rust on the underside. And of course the pad area's also got a little bit of patina going. But these tools do not show up very often. And here we have the finished product. Now with a tool like this, the goal of a restoration isn't to make it back, take it back to shiny, which I doubt this guy ever was. It was just to take off some of the, like I said, current patina, currently acquired patina, and make it just look more like it would have been when it was actually in use. You can see the graining of the wrought iron on it. The chuck end cleaned up a little bit. Of course, you need the right size bits for it. Inside the pad, still has some rust. This section here looks like it's copper. I didn't push the cleaning on that too hard, but still kind of neat. The pad does have some sharp edges. I'm sure this guy's been dropped more than once, and Normally, I would take a file to those or get a little more aggressive about cleaning them, but since I didn't want to get too aggressive with that, I left them as is. Here's the back of the pad. But it's my opinion, this is a very, very, very nice brace, very nice tool. Kind of tool used to sell for $200 plus, but these days, it's going to be interesting. Here we have an early Distin 14-inch bevel square. These usually aren't signed, but you can tell them by the distinctive cast brass screw. And this one's actually in fairly good shape. Yeah, but he's got some scuffing and light wear, but it still has most of the gray finish on it. The handle's got user initials and stains and dings, but it's solid. Get there. And these bigger ones rarely show up. I mean, even Stanley made a 14-incher, and in good shape, those do command a premium. At least they used to, but sometimes you see even bigger ones out there. Sometimes once in a while you find an English one, but this is about as big as the United States guys made them. Here we have another draw knife. This one's marked warranted cast steel, but the name's pretty well gone. I'm thinking it's possibly English, but hard to say. Somebody else replaced the handles on this guy, but they actually did a pretty good job of it. I mean, they're sawing on tight, and trust me, I've seen worse. And it's got some patina here on the front. The back, you can see the transition line here between the steel and the iron frame, and the iron frame has a repair to it, but it's solid because somebody's been using this guy. Steel back has some scuffs and what have you, but nothing too bad. It's definitely usable. It's not pretty, but sometimes you gotta take what you get. In a previous flea market find section, I mentioned finding this 18th century wing compass or divider. At the time, it was buried with gold paint, and it also had a newer screw that was just kind of jammed in the hole there for effect. It didn't really do anything, and I didn't bother to mess with it. This is actually signed. This is made by John Parsons. He's listed in the 1818 Wrightson's Directory of Birmingham, England, as a compass and pincher maker. He was probably working before that, but I only have 1818 as my earliest Birmingham Directory entries. And it's in decent shape for the age. Under the gold paint, it was pretty heavily rusted. Also, a user kind of put his mark in a couple places on, a more recent user, but you don't find them very often, and when you do, they're rarely in great shape anymore, unless you want to spend a lot of money for one, so. But it's still a neat find and a very collectible tool. And here we have what's called a gunstock or gunstocker's plane. This one was user-modified, as most of them are, and it cuts a 7/8 of an inch round channel in the stock to fit the barrel. This one's in decent shape. Looks like it had an extra piece added to the fence at some point. It's probably made from an old skew rabbet. Wedge was replaced, but again, you don't see these guys too often. I can count on probably all fingers of both hands, the number that I've seen in the past 15 years or so. And well, yeah, Wedge took some doing to get out the first time around. But again, kind of a neat collectible plane. I'll take a quick look here at a couple of recent restoration projects I did. First off is this plum Boy Scout hatchet. Still has the original handle on it. Some of the paint is mostly red with the green trim, but that's kind of worn off. It's not in too bad a shape. It's got a little patina on the head, but nothing too bad. According to what I've seen, this is a World War II vintage. I haven't seen that in print anywhere. Just the usual rantings and ravings of certain sellers online, but I guess that's what we'll go with. The other one is this bluegrass Belknap Hardware paw hammer. Belknap was a Louisville, Kentucky hardware dealer and maker, 1840 to 1986. And the tools are fairly collectible. I sure don't see too many of them around here. They just never seem to float up this way. But all in all, this one's in pretty good shape. Little bit of wear, a little bit of patina, but handle solid and on tight. So couple of nice tools that turned out pretty well. If you watched my last week's video, I was babbling a little bit about this particular marking gauge. This is a Stanley 161. The pretty much identical to the Stanley 61, the most common beach gauge, but it has a metal fence attached. That fence was patented by Justice A. Trout on January 12th, 1886, although it's believed that he copied somebody else's design for it. This one is sheet iron, but most of them you see are stamped brass. Once in a while, you'll see one that's made of cast brass. There's no real rhyme or reason to it. And I say this because, you see a steel piece here where you'd have a brass one, and most folks think, well, it's World War II. But the mark on this guy is definitely not World War II vintage, because they were using the notched rectangle by then. So, anyways, enough with the history. This one cleaned up, okay. It's got a lot of staining. The beam has got some dings in it from where it swelled up a bit and got stuck inside the fence, but fortunately it shrunk back down. I was able to get it out. But the screw works. The point's not too bad. The beam's got a little chip in there, and I see a little paint that I must have missed. And the fence does have some pitting on it. Not a perfect example, but again, this is not a very common Stanley gauge. And they made, besides the 161 and 61 combo, they made the 62 and a 162, and they made the number 65 and a 165 as well. Those are also very collectible. So, anyways, just thought you might want to know the facts. Well, the Sunday flea market was pretty much of a bust this week. And the Wednesday one wasn't much better. They're calling for some quick bit of nasty in the forecast later on, so that cut the vendor count. I mean, there was about one-third of the people there this week as there were last week. But what are you going to do, right? Anyways, I got this pretty neat crate hammer, box hammer, whatever you want to call it, handles hand-forged on it. Hand-forged scraper, needs some cleaning. Kind of neat, I guess, a tack hammer. It does have a mark on it. You can see that, pretty good shape, minor cleaning. Stanley 7A Herwood awl, not too bad a shape. Little crescent, 4-inch adjustable wrench. A Lindstrom Sweden jeweler's pliers in good shape. And A neat little bench vise. People call these jeweler's vices, but they're just, if it's a toy vise, whatever, but I get them from time to time, so. Not a great pile, but as long as I can pay for the gas and maybe a little of the time involved, I should be okay. And that's it for this one, folks. Hope you enjoyed my presentation as always. And if you'd like to be notified when new videos are posted, please hit that subscribe button. Thanks for watching, and bye.